through our lives that God doesn't have a word for. And usually there's a promise of what He'll do on our behalf. Years ago, I was visiting with an elderly lady in the hospital on behalf of my pastor, Franklin. And when I visited her, I saw her weary. Many times she was feeble, extremely feeble. And she was faint, hard to stay awake, hard to keep her eyes open. Because of the rough struggle she was going through. But every time, even so she was like that, in going through that, she always had praise for her Lord. Every time I would come into the room and I'd say hi, she'd say, "Well, praise God." My Lord is good. I noted that the promise found in Isaiah 40:29 was very applicable to her situation. When you read that, it says in the NIV, "He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak." I saw that happen in her. She would have a hard time talking with the medical staff. She'd have a hard time conversing with her family, though she tried very hard. But as soon as she began to praise God, she had all kinds of strength. Charles Spurgeon, evangelist, writer, once wrote, "When you read such a promise in the Word, take it back to the great promiser and ask Him to fulfill His word." But I add, it must be in the right attitude. Never ask God to fulfill a promise He's made in a selfish manner, just so you look better. Ask Him to fulfill His promise so you are better. First time I read that, I had to go back and reread it and rethink that, because I thought, doesn't that make us a little bit arrogant, making demands of God to do what He said for us? And then I realized, the attitude has to be right, but the promises are for us, because God's true to His word. I can almost imagine this lady that I was visiting in the hospital. When she would be alone, I can almost imagine hearing her ask the Lord to continue to fulfill His promise in her, that she may be strong enough to praise Him at every opportunity, to the medical staff, to her family, to her friends, even to her own spirit. As long as she had breath, she had praise. The great promiser did that for her. Even when not able to speak, I noticed this. Her friends, her family, would talk of her faith. They would talk of her testimony. They would talk of her life for Christ, in Christ. And each of their conversations brought praise to the Lord, because they were repeating the praises she had given all her life. Oh, that we might live a life like that. That when they hear us, see us, or know us, get to know us, they would sense the closeness we would have in Christ Jesus. And that our life would be a praise. Not even having to say a word, but having them notice and see and evaluate, there's someone who knows the Lord. That should be the goal of every one of us. Have you checked on your spiritual hunger and your spiritual thirst lately? What's he talking about? You see, we're supposed to always be craving a deeper relationship. And the only way we can have that deeper relationship is if our thirst is quenched and our bellies are full. Not to take a nap,
which most of us do,
but to serve. Maybe spiritually, some of the testimonies. Maybe spiritually you're seeking after Christ and wanting a closer relationship or patience. Or to put a cap on frustration.
I'm there.
Maybe we just want a deeper communication with Him. Or to sense a deeper presence with Him. Well, Matthew 5:6 is another promise found in the Word of God. This is the Sermon on the Mount. This is Jesus speaking. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Now the promise there is, if we are hungry and we are thirsty, we will be filled. It doesn't say you might be filled. If we're hungering and thirsting after the right things of Jesus, He says, you will be filled. And the right things of Jesus are His righteousness, not our own. Take His promise. Take His promise. This promise. Take His promise to us, to the throne of our Lord daily. Take it continually and plead over and over again with this petition. Lord, you have said this to me, now do in me as you have said. The promise is for us. But we have to ask to have it fulfilled in us. We can do this till we are filled and our thirst is quenched. And Jesus is never offended when we ask that His promises be made real in us. Especially if it makes us a better child of God. A more spiritual, discerning, obedient child of God. We don't ask for Him to fulfill the promises to make us look better. Too often, Christians want to look better than they know they are. Why not just go to Him and say, would you make me as good as I want to be or you want me to be? Instead of just looking like it, I want to be that way. And Lord, whatever it takes, make it so. Maybe today, sin may be harassing you, or memories of past sin has become a heavy burden, too heavy to carry, and you are about to be crushed under the load. I go through this all the time, because it happens to all of us. That's the way Satan beats up on us. He takes our past, and he brings it, see what you did? And if we let Him, we dwell on it and we feel miserable and Then the Holy Spirit comes and says, hey, you remember that time you went to the altar and you asked Jesus to forgive you? Well, do you know that he doesn't remember those sins? Satan does, and you do. But you're clean. You're free. You're saved. You're his. You don't belong to anybody but him. Maybe harassing memories. I'm just sharing with Renee some of the things I remember in my military service, and I want to share them with my grandchildren. And I remember some of the things that we were taught to do. And I was thinking about it this morning before I got up. I was thinking, I was taught to kill. I was taught to kill without even thinking about it. I was taught to kill or be killed. And it wasn't until Jesus that it all got put right in perspective. To kill without even thinking about it is not a nice place to live. And it does make for some nasty memories. But as that comes to my mind, I keep thinking, Jesus took all of that stuff and he started to make it make sense and he put it in the right order. I didn't know how to do it, but he did. I still know how to kill. I just don't want to now. I still can be killed. I don't want that either. But I have learned that I will defend myself and my family to save them. And if I have to, I would kill to protect them. I wouldn't like it, I wouldn't want to, but I would do it. Because every one of us are capable. When a loved one is threatened, you'd be amazed what comes up from inside. I didn't mean to spend a whole lot of time on that, but that's one of the things that Satan likes to use against me. And so, when it overwhelms me and overburdens me and it starts to rob me of joy, there's a promise in God's Word I like to hang on to. I like to keep a hold of this. Isaiah 43:25. But I, yes, I am. We know what I am means. The one who takes care of your sins, that's what I do. I love that in the Message. I'm the one who takes care of your sins because that's what I do. That's God. And it goes on to say, I don't keep a list of your sins. Whoa, thank you, Jesus. Now there's some promises we can hang on to. There's promises we can live by. These are promises that will give us life. We have no merits on our own to even consider that God would not keep track of our sins. We have no merit or grace within ourselves to even plead for him to not remember our sins. He offers it before we even ask. Now that's only God can do that. And by using his own words, praying his own words, praying his promises made to us, he can and will perform them just as he said. Because his word is true. If he said it, it's true. If he said it, it can happen. If he said it, it's for us.
Amen.
When we are alone or lonely, and we've all been there, at times we lose that closeness with the Lord. His presence, our sense of his closeness is gone, and we wonder where he went. When it is we who have wandered away, not him. We have this promise, and this is another great promise. Malachi 3:7. Return to me so I can return to you, says the God of the angel armies. Do you realize what that's saying? If we turn to God, he will return to us. All we've got to do is turn to him, and he will return to us. You want to get a relationship restored? Turn to God and let him come turning back to you. If we turn and head back to him, this is what that verse is saying. If we turn and head back to him, he will not wait on us to get there. Our Lord will come to us and meet us on the way back, just as in the parable of the prodigal. And that's why Jesus told that parable. That's our promise. That the Father is always looking across the horizon for his child to come back.
Amen.
And when he sees that child, even afar off, he will run to him and meet him on the way. That's the God we serve. He seeks us out. Even when we're not even looking for him. That promise is based in love. That's the great love of God for us. That we don't fathom completely. Not only do we have that promise of a God who seeks us out, we have one that assures us of all those prior ones. And it's Isaiah 54:7. And in that verse it says, I left you, but only for a moment. Now, with enormous compassion, I'm bringing you back. He's not going to let us go. He's going to bring us back. He will do everything he possibly can to get us to come back to him. These are promises of God for us. These are the word we can hang on to. These are the words that give life, that bolster our relationship. And speaking of the children of Israel in that verse, but I left you but only for a moment. He's a heavenly father that loves his children, and sometimes he's got to let the children learn by getting into their own situation. But as soon as they turn and ask for help, there he is. Now, with enormous compassion, I'm bringing you back. That means he will not only bring us back into the fold, he's going to restore us to where we were. We don't have to start all over. Because if we had to start all over, there's a lot of us who would be clear back at the beginning. The Word of God can and will meet us at our deepest need with promises, comfort, and hope. We need to use them, pray them, and believe them. Look for them. And as that dear lady in the hospital said to me, how can anyone live without the Lord? Then she would always add, I know I can't. How many times since then have I thought, yes, dear lady, neither can we. So why do we keep trying to live without Him? These are only a handful of promises. The Bible is full of them. And they are all for us. They're not for somebody else. They're not for some other nation. They're not for some other country. They're for us. And we need to rejoice in the fact that He loves us that much. And that every promise that He has put into His Word can be real in our lives. Look for them, find them, pray them, use them, hang on to them. Memorize them, whatever you do that works best for you. But don't forget, the one who gave them, we've got to ask Him to make them real in our lives. We've got to ask. Could you stand, please? Our Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the promises. Lord, we don't know them all. We haven't found them all. We probably won't find them all. But Lord, each one we find, help us to make it a reality in our own lives. Help us to ask You, Lord God, make this real in me. Because Your love for us is so amazing. We cannot even fathom it. But as we look upon these words and we hear testimonies of Your saints, we realize, God, Your love is deeper and wider than anything we have ever seen or fathomed. You really do care for us. We are not on this journey alone. Lord, help us each one, this day even, put our hand in Your hand and walk with You the rest of our days. As we leave this place today, Lord, I'm going to pray that Your hand would rest upon each one. Whatever the relationship is that you have with them, keep your hand on them, Lord. If they don't have a relationship with you, you said you will draw them to you. I pray that would become a reality. You told us to baptize the lost in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, to convert them with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, let our lives show the gospel of Jesus Christ. May Your blessing be upon each one, upon this church, upon this congregation. May we be an influence in this community because Jesus is real in our lives.